We're now going into our 1 minute mingle. So if you'd like to take this time to say hello to someone in your house, or we have the online chat where you can connect with one of us.
Hey, welcome everybody. I'm so glad that you've tuned in today to what is, I think, the 19th, 20th week of our broadcast online, and we're delighted that you are with us today. I trust that today's message and the worship and the leaders really encouraged your heart already. But I also want to say a big thank you to those who've been sending me stories and anecdotes. They're very much appreciated. So I've got one that's here, a little bit risky, but we'll just go for it. There was an elderly man, and he was in the last few days of his life. He was actually ready to be with Jesus, but he smelt the aroma of his wife's favourite homemade chocolate chip cookies. Are you slavering already? And he got out of bed, and he headed slowly towards the kitchen. And the closer he got, the more excited he became. Those cookies. He was thinking, what a beautiful wife. There was one final act of heroic love, seeing to it that he left this world a very happy man. In labored breath, he leaned against the door frame, gazing wide-eyed into the kitchen. And there, spread upon the kitchen table, were literally hundreds of his favorite chocolate chip cookies. Heaven, I'm in heaven. He didn't break out into song, actually. I just threw it in for the sake of it. But he mustered one final effort, and his aged and withered hand was quivering. And he made his way to a cookie near the edge of the table, and he felt the warmth of the soft dough. His parched lips were savouring the wondrous taste of this wonderful cookie in his mouth. He then reached for another cookie. What then was this sudden stinging that caused his hand to recoil? And he looked to see his wife. Still holding a spatula she had just used to smack his hand. "Stay out of those cookies," she said. "They're for your funeral." "Ouch! Oh, is that, have I gone too far? That is bad, eh? They're for your funeral." I want to say, that person who sent it to me, I found it really, really funny. Anyway, come on, tap on your screens, get tapping. As always, for those who are new here today, and we give you a really warm welcome to our online service. We're Arena Church, just a church that's full of ordinary people who love Jesus with all of our hearts. And we're one church in seven locations. So come on, get typing. Belper, come on, get it typing on. Shout out, Belper. Now we'll want to go to the Hub. Yes, I love the Hub. And we see you guys. Wonderful. Now to Ilkeston. A big shout out to Ilkeston. Now to Mansfield. Come on, you Mansfield people. Now to Nottingham, that great city that we're planting a church in. Wonderful. Now to the online. This is your church. We're delighted that you've made it and you're with us. And also, last but not least, to our good friends over there in Toulouse. Come on, get typing on the screens. Get shouting out every location. It's really great that we're still able to gather as we are. And I just love the fact that we're gathering here online together. And there's just something of what God's doing amongst us. Let me say this. Thank you for those people who send in letters to the office through email and just notes and text messages. What God is doing in your life, it's wonderful. Let me say, we may not be gathering physically, but we're gathering remotely, and God is still at work. God is building his church. For those who are going to be going away on staycation, you've not managed to get out of the country, I want to encourage you to keep getting online for your convenience. We've got three services, 10:30, 3 p.m., 7 p.m. And for those who literally cannot make it for whatever reason, then we want to encourage you to go and look on our YouTube site. Go onto YouTube, type in Arena Church, and you'll be able to see the messages from previous weeks. This few weeks that we're running in the summer, this is our summer series, we're talking about parables. And for those who don't know, those who may have read the Bible a lot, or those people who've never read the Bible, you still may know that Jesus delivered some absolutely brilliant truths in the New Testament when he walked the earth. But he often used parables. Now, what are these parables? Well, Jesus used them because he wanted to illustrate deep spiritual truths, and he used the language of the day or symbols of the day or thoughts of the day. So for example, bread. He used bread. He used sheep. He used the thought of lostness to convey a deep and divine truth. But he also used these parables because he was endeavoring to draw people in with intrigue. He wanted to create some interest. So they didn't fully understand it, but they were leaning in, and not just they were leaning in, but their hearts were leaning in. And it was Jesus was using them to try and create some receptive insight from the listeners. And you're here today, and you're on the broadcast, and there's a load of people who are very different on the broadcast. There's people who are from church background for years, some people who've started coming to church, some people here for the very first time. And all I'd encourage you to do is just open up your heart and just receive the messages that God is wanting to share with you. And he's wanting to draw you. He's wanting to create some interest in you. And the series of parables is exactly that. Over the next 5 weeks, we're going to be taking a parable that Jesus told in the New Testament, in the Gospels. And we wanted to just unpack the truth that Jesus was wanting to share. But today I want to just take a classic. Who loves a classic? I absolutely love, I love classic music, not classical music. I love classic music. I love classic cars. I love classic fashion. In fact, my kids say, Dad, you're a bit of a classic. What they're saying there is, I'm a bit old. But I love classics. And there's a classic parable that many people know, and it's the Good Samaritan. So let's take a look, shall we? And it's found in Luke in chapter 10 and verse 25 through to 42. It's quite a lengthy passage, but we're going to read it together rather than me tell the story. And as always, if you'd like a Bible, the most precious book that you can own, and you haven't got one, then please let us know. Tap on the screen now and we'll send one to you. Or alternatively, you can download in this technical age an app called YouVersion, and you can get all different Bibles on there. It's a wonderful, wonderful app. So Luke 10, verse 25 through to 42. Are you ready? Just tap on the screen, say, I'm ready, I'm ready. Tap the neighbor, say, I'm ready, I'm ready. Oh, I feel like I want to break out into an American pastor called T.D. Jakes. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Anyway, there we go. Luke 10, verse 25 through to 42. It reads, just then a religious scholar stood before Jesus in order to test his doctrines. And he posed this question. Teacher, what requirement must I fulfill if I want to live forever in heaven? That's a great question, by the way. Let me just stop there just for a moment. That's a great question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to get to heaven? And at the end of this broadcast, you'll hopefully understand a little bit more of what you need to do. And I'm encouraging you to put your trust in Jesus and have a certainty that you will be with him forever. Verse 26, well, Jesus replied, well, what does Moses teach, the Old Testament prophet? What do you read in the law? And the religious scholar answered, it states, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your passion, with all your energy, and with every thought. And you must love your neighbor as well as you love yourself. And Jesus said, that is correct. Now go and do exactly that, and you will live. Verse 29, wanting to justify himself, he questioned Jesus further, saying, what do you mean by my neighbor? Did you get that? He wanted to justify himself. He wanted to drive further into trying to, I think, use a little bit of trickery around Jesus. And verse 30, Jesus replied, listen, I will tell you. There was a Jewish man, and he was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho when bandits robbed him along the way. They beat him severely, they stripped him naked, and they left him half dead. Soon a Jewish priest, walking down the same road, came upon the wounded man. Seeing him from a distance, the priest crossed to the other side of the road and walked right past him, not turning to help him one bit. Later, a religious man, a Levite, came walking down the same road. And likewise, he crossed to the other side to pass by the wounded man without stopping to help him. Finally, another man, a Samaritan, came upon the bleeding man and was moved with tender compassion for him. He stooped down and gave him first aid, pouring olive oil on his wounds, disinfecting them with his wine and bandaging them to stop the bleeding. Lifting him up, he placed him on his own donkey and brought him to an inn. Then he took from his donkey and carried him to the room for the night. And the next morning he took his own money from his wallet and gave it to the innkeeper with these words, "Take care of him until I come back from my journey. If it costs more than this, I will repay you when I return." Verse 36. "So now, tell me, which one of these three men who saw the wounded man proved to be the true neighbor?" And the religious scholar responded, "The one who demonstrated kindness and mercy." And then Jesus said, "Now you must go and do the same as he." One version says, Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." This is a remarkable parable. It's a classic, as I've already said. Many people have seen this played out in many different ways. I even can recollect a school assembly many, many years ago. I was in an Anglican Church of England school, and we had to dramatize this classical parable. There are many aspects to this parable that we could drive into. For example, there are some people who've wanted to talk about the Jewish religious people and how they turned away from the needs of others. I don't necessarily want to speak into that. There are people who want to, you know, really drive into, you know, injustices that are in the world, and we'll touch on that. But really what I want to pursue today are three principal things. And what I want to do is drive into this text, into this parable, and try and understand, guys, for those who are listening, what can we learn? What is this parable wanting to teach us? I want to look with fresh perspective. Again, I want to encourage you, just on the screens, right, fresh perspective. It's interesting, you can read something and read something 100 times, and then you just read over it. But I pray that we look at this with fresh perspective, through new eyes. And I've narrowed it down to just three principal points that I want to look at today from this story. So you ready? Are you sure you're ready? Great, let's dive into it, shall we? Number one, it's important that we understand that we must live without prejudice. Live without prejudice. I want to just state the obvious. The Samaritan took care of the Jew. Now, I visited the old Yugoslavia and Eastern Europe in the late 80s into 90s. In fact, I was there just before the Balkans War broke out. Many people who we were working with, many of them died through war and through the civil war that happened there, through as a result of the ethnic cleansing that was there. Hatred from one group, from one tribe to another. What about the hatred of the Protestants and the Catholics? Not all of them, in Ireland. The IRA, you know, and all that stuff that goes there, and the unionists, terrible, terrible things. But what about the hatred from right-wing groups and movements to people of different cultures and colours? Hatred in our world. But here we see, in Jesus' time, there was a hatred, there was a dislike, there was a despising from Jews to Samaritans and from Samaritans to Jews. Generally speaking, they didn't interact. They didn't like each other. They despised each other, both racially and religiously. And the culture gave the Samaritan, I understand it's a story, but Jesus told this on purpose. This The culture of the day gave the Samaritan plenty of reasons to hate this Jewish man, even though he was lying in the gutter. Now, since this story was initiated by a lawyer, I've thought about this. I suspect everybody, because he quoted, you know, a Jewish priest, then he looked at a Levite, and everybody was thinking, he's going to now talk about a lawyer, you know, who's going to come and save the day, who's going to show up on the scene. So when Jesus said, a Samaritan, there was can you imagine just being there as Jesus is telling this story? There would have been a gasp from the Jewish audience. Such was the prejudice. But Jesus is trying to help us through this parable to understand we must live without prejudice. In fact, there needs to be the removal of prejudice. Because there needed to be the removal of prejudice for this Samaritan man to the Jew. Because he would have been brought up with prejudice. And he had to remove all prejudice when he saw this Jewish man. You see, prejudice can be ingrained from generations, family histories, lack of education and understanding. This prejudice works out not just with color, but to the police. People hate the police. They hate the law. They hate law and order. And usually if they're from a criminal background, they're the enemy, enemy number one. Some people see that about school and education. What about the traveler community? People hate the travelers. I was reading, Jonathan and Annie had brought me a book, the Tyson Fury autobiography. I'm sorry if you're not into boxing, but I just wanted to read about his story. It's a fascinating read in many ways because it highlights some of the issues that he had to grow up in. And he cites, as a traveler, how he had to, moving around from different areas, walking into schools and people picking on him and saying all kinds of unkind things. Listen to me, guys. It's not just color. It's those things that are prejudice. It's terrible. What about people who are poor to rich people? Oh, those rich people, they haven't got a clue. Never mind that some of those wealthy people have really worked very hard to get where they are and are very generous. What about those rich people who say about those poor people, they need to get a job, they need to get off the backsides, when actually many of those people are trying to make good of their lives? It's prejudices. And what about people who say all kinds of things to the infirm and to the disabled? Guys, these are prejudices. And Jesus is addressing this in this parable. This is a great summer message because we must make sure that we live without prejudice, and we remove all prejudices from our lives. I can't continue without making mention of this. I don't want to open up too much in this moment. That'll come at a later date. But over the recent events of the world that has really showcased a prejudice of whites to blacks, particularly in North America, there's just been some people who've been quick to rush in and sought to say some things. And then I've challenged people who haven't said some things. But let me tell you, our position at Arena Church has been this. We've wanted to take the words of the scriptures. We need to be slow to speak and we need to be quick to listen. And we have been listening and we have been learning and we have been leaning in. And one of the things that I've been very challenged by is how we can live with conscious and unconscious bias. And let me tell you, if we live with a conscious bias, that is completely wrong. But let me tell you, we can live with unconscious bias, and that is completely wrong. That is completely wrong. And we will endeavor to speak into that into the autumn. But let me tell you, and this is where I've been slow to speak and quick to listen. We do not need a political movement called Black Lives Matter, or a left-wing or right-wing uprising to change the behaviors and practices of people. Listen to me very carefully. We need a kingdom uprising. We need a change of heart. We need the church to be exactly what Jesus has asked us to be. And the church needs to live out the principles that Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 5. And before I move on quickly, because I'm aware this is a long point, but I want to make this point. Because it's really important. In Matthew 5, Jesus expresses, we call them the Beatitudes, or the attitudes that we should live with. Just listen to them for a moment. From verse 3, God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. God blesses those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the earth. God blesses those who hunger and thirst for justice, for they'll be satisfied. God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy. God blesses those who are pure of heart, for they will see God. God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called children of God. God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That is a manifesto to build your life upon. And Jesus is challenging the hearers to remove all prejudice, to live without prejudice. I've been praying a prayer. I prayed over this in my life, but I pray over my life completely. Psalm 51 verse 10, David prayed this, create in me a clean heart. Create a new clean heart within me. And then he says, fill me with pure thoughts and holy desires, ready to please you. If you've lived with prejudice, injustice, may God begin to create a new clean heart within you. And may he fill you with pure thoughts and holy desires, ready to please him. Secondly, what does this parable teach us? We need to show compassion to all. We need to show compassion to all. It says in verse 33, finally, there was a man. As the other two religious men passed by, there was another man, a Samaritan. I've already told you about the hatred. This Samaritan, he came upon this bleeding man and was moved with tender compassion for him. That word is so, so important, tender compassion. It means to have your bowels and intestines yearn. It means that you need to quickly rush to the toilet. Sorry to be so graphic. This wasn't a whim. There was something deep within him that saw this man and saw the needs of this man. And his heart was moved to urgency and to go and do something. And this is what we're talking about. We show compassion to everybody. Listen to me, too many people are moved by sentiment and emotion. Now, God is an emotional God, but he's not a sentimental God. But let me tell you, sentiment and emotion may start a campaign, may start the work, but compassion finishes it. Compassion is the marathon runner. It sees things to completion. It breaks through the pain. What do I mean? Well, let me give you an example. There can be some people out of sentiment and emotion start a campaign. We want to feed the hungry. We want to help the children in our neighborhood. We want to reach out to the immigrants. It's all sentiment and emotion. Can be. But if it's rooted in compassion, it's not just starting it. But they will pay the price and they will go out of their way and they will take the backlash from onlookers to go and finish the work. This Samaritan man was not filled with just sentiment and emotion. He had compassion, tender compassion at his core. Can I encourage those who are from Arena Church to live with compassion, to have compassionate hearts, to fall on your knees and say, God, give me more compassion, your love for my neighbor. Who is my neighbor? I've already told you, whoever's near us, whoever's around us, whoever's in need. Whoever they are, and may I live with compassion. This compassionate Samaritan of this story. Let me just give you a few things quickly. One, he risked his life. It was a dangerous road. And often gangs would lie in ambush. And Jesus knew the hearers wouldn't understand the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. It was a dangerous road. The second thing is, he gave of his time, this Samaritan. What time is some of the most precious thing we can give to anything. And, you know, to give the time to look in people's eyes, to give them attention, to give them thought, to let them know that they're not invisible. This is just something that's so powerful. And he gave him his time. And I'm sure this Samaritan of the story was planning to go somewhere, but he didn't get where he was going because he sorted this man. And that's what compassion does. It's with inconvenience. And he met the need. He paid the price. One version says he gave 2 denarii, which was a day's wage, which would have effectively given 2 weeks' stay for this Jew in an inn. He paid it out of his own pocket. And he broke through all the protocol. I've already said to you, Samaritans don't mix with Jews, and Jews don't mix with Samaritans. But this Samaritan broke through all of that because his compassionate, tender heart compelled him to go and do it. Now listen to me. You've heard me say we must always do the right thing even when everybody else is doing the wrong thing. But let me tell you, a better way of putting this gospel truth is do the only thing. It wasn't just doing the right thing this Samaritan did. He did the only thing. What I mean by this is Jesus was saying, in essence, this Samaritan loved God totally, so he couldn't do anything else. The Samaritan, he had tender compassion, and instantaneously and instinctively, without a second thought, he didn't have to think it through, he released compassion. True love invades both the interior and exterior of a man's world. This doesn't mean that we run after every need that presents itself. The Samaritan didn't set up a hospital for injured Jews or, you know, those on the road to Jerusalem to Jericho. No. But he met the need in that moment. And Alexander McLaren, a Scottish minister of the 19th century, said this: the world would be a better place if every Christian attended to sorrows that are plain before him. Listen to me, guys. We need to remove prejudice and we need to show compassion to everybody. But the third thing and the final thing that I want to say is this: Jesus is a type of the Samaritan. You may say, really? Yeah, absolutely. Could it be that the Samaritan was a representation of Jesus? Matthew 20, verse 28 says this: the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus is the type of the Samaritan, and let me prove it to you why. Because there are many ways that Jesus lived his life like this Samaritan. Listen to me. Number one, the Samaritan was an outsider. He was despised by many. And Jesus himself was an outsider, and he was despised and rejected by men. The Samaritan came after others failed to meet the need. It's like Jesus. Jesus came after others failed to meet the need. The Samaritan came before it was too late. This is what Jesus does for our lives. And if you're here on the broadcast today and you're in great need and you're in great loss and you've been injured, both in your heart and physically, if this sin is weighing you down and you've tried everything, let me tell you, Jesus comes to you and it's not too late, sir. It's not too late, madam, for you to call on God, for you to recognize that Jesus is your Savior who hung upon a cross and forgave all of your sins. And all I'd ask you to do towards the end of this broadcast is just begin to call out to God. Ask Jesus to become your friend and he will do exactly that. Jesus came before it was too late. The Samaritan came with everything necessary, as did Jesus. Jesus came with everything. He laid down all of heaven and came as a man and came and served the world. The Samaritan came to right the afflicted man. I've already mentioned this. Listen to me. We're all afflicted. We're all afflicted. We're all sinful. We're all broken. We're all battered. We're all bruised. But Jesus came. Jesus came. And he made right the afflicted man. Can you imagine the look of the Jews, this man's eyes, the shame of his nakedness, the severity of his beating, and to look into this man's eyes and know that all was well. In that moment, he didn't know whether he was going to get it, finish him off. But when he began to just pour in the oil, as he began to disinfect him wounds, as he began to bandage him, he knew that all was well. Could you imagine the Jew looking into the Samaritan's eyes and knowing that all is well? And this is like Jesus. I remember the day, guys, when I knew I needed Jesus and I looked into his face and I knew that all was going to be well. All was going to be well because Jesus loved me and he came to me in that moment. And that is what I feel today. Jesus is coming to your living room. He's coming to that kitchen. He's coming to that car. And in this moment, he looks into your eyes. If you will open up your eyes, a new, fresh perspective, and you will see that all will be well in the arms of Jesus. The Samaritan gave tender care. There was nothing strange about this man holding this other man. He gave him tender care. I remember when I used to play football, you'd carry another guy off a pitch who was in agony, broke his leg. We didn't have all those stretchers and all the mamby-bamby oxygen like they get in the Premiership. You had to rough it. But I remember you'd make sure that the guy, the player, even if it was the opposition, you gave them tender care, you helped them off. And this is what Jesus does, guys, as the Samaritan did. Have you got it? It's a type of Jesus. And lastly, the Samaritan provided for future needs. He didn't just leave him. He said, listen, I'll pay for his 2-week stay. And if there's anything further, I'll pay it forward. That's Jesus. Oh, Jesus meets every one of our needs, not our wants. He takes care of our life. Some people say, why do you trust in Jesus? I trust in Jesus because I want to live my life well on earth. And the best way to live my life is living it in and through Jesus. It's not a killjoy. It's full of fun. It's not about what you can't do. It's what you can do and what you can enjoy. And you live with a freedom and a hope and a joy in your heart. But beyond this life, guys, as well, it's very important. I don't just trust in Jesus for this life. I trust him for my life to come. There's people that we've lost recently over these last 6-9 months. We know we will be with them in eternity if we put our trust in him. So the takeaway from this parable is we've got to remove prejudice. Any prejudice in your heart. We've got to live with compassion to all. But we also need to understand that the Samaritan is a type of Jesus. And for some people, you need to simply receive Jesus into your heart. Jesus finished this parable by saying, making sure the lawyer got it, which he did. Who is my neighbor? He got it. Out of the three, the one who took care of the needs. And then Jesus said, go and do likewise. Come on, let's type it on the screen. Let's say to the person at the side of you, or even if you're on your own, go and do. You're not loud enough. Go and do. Come on, one more time. Go and do. If we will do that, we will live out this parable. May we love God with all of our heart, might, and strength. May we love our neighbor with compassion and without prejudice. Quickly, before I pray, why don't we do this for 30 days? Here's a thought, church. Why don't we go and really make a difference over these 30 days? Every day, how come if we've lived with prejudice or we've said some things, how can we say something positive? If there's some people who you've had trouble with, why don't you pray for them? Pray for them over these next 30 days and ask God to give you a deep love for them. If you have an issue with the police, pray for the police every single day. If you've taken, ridiculed people who are poor or rich, you know what I'm talking about. You pray for those people every single day. I guarantee you God will begin to do a change in your heart if you do it sincerely. But how about these next 30 days? Showing compassion, showing love, meeting the needs that stare us in the face. Not looking to the one side. We've all been there. Where you know that somebody needs some help, but you walk the other way, you know. Why don't we show compassion over these next 30 days? And as we do so, we will live out this parable in our 21st century. Have you got it, guys? Have you really got it? Do you receive that? I know it's a simple message, but the parables unpack deep spiritual truths in a simple way. And this is the story that Jesus told, so I feel like I'm in good company, because if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Why don't we just bow our heads in this moment? Oh my goodness, I felt a real fresh leap of faith. People who are on the broadcast for the first time, he's your Samaritan. He's the Samaritan Savior. He comes, he wants to meet your needs. He wants to bandage those wounds. He wants to take care of your needs. He loves you. He loves you unconditionally. He cares for you. And I want to ask you in this moment, will you put your trust in him? Just bow your heads. If you say this morning, Christian, I so want Jesus. I so want a Savior. I so want to know what it is to live with purpose and joy and peace in my heart. Well, in this moment, just reach out. Just say this prayer with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for the way I've lived. In this moment, I put my trust in you. My confidence is in you. Be my Savior and be my Lord. The Bible says that if you've prayed that prayer sincerely, then you've begun the journey of faith. In fact, the Bible says that all heaven, angels are rejoicing in this moment, which is amazing. But there is a journey for you to go on, and I encourage you in this moment to just click on the screen to let one of the hosts know that you've given your life to Jesus. You know, they'll, if you want to, they'll send you some information, but equally you can go on our website, you can find out more information, but don't stop this journey. What God has begun in you, let him finish it. It's really, really important. I'd like to, in our living rooms, there are people who are responding, come on, let's give a big shout of praise. I want to tell you that all across the world and all across the country, people are reaching out to Lord and putting their trust in him. It's wonderful, it's exciting, it's passionate, it's dynamic. The kingdom of God is forcefully advancing. But secondly, why don't we engage in this 30 days of change? Come on, just lean in this moment. Oh Jesus, any prejudice in my heart, search me, Lord. Create in me a new and clean heart. Oh God, remove those prejudices from our lives. We want to live openly and expansively and purely before you. And we want to live and serve and love the world that's around us. Help me over these next 30 days, Lord, to pray for those who I've struggled with, those enemies of mine. Lord, I want to pray for them. But more than that, I also want to serve them. I pray, Lord, that over these next 30 days, we would make a difference in our world. And everybody said together, amen, and amen, and amen. Come on, you're not loud enough. I want a big shout, amen. Wonderful. Really looking forward to this series, looking forward to hearing the guys who are gonna be sharing over this time. Continue to lean in, guys. You know, wherever you are, continue to lean in. And as always, guys, I love you, I believe in you, I'm praying for you. God bless you.
Who else is really blessed by the teaching and preaching we get in Arena Church? You know, if you're thankful, if you've enjoyed it, if it spoke to you, why don't you just pop an encouraging message into the chat on my side right now? The Bible says we were encouraged last week not just to be hearers of the word, but to be doers of it. And honestly, if we all did as much as we talk, the world would be changed. We're going to sing our last song together right now. So I wonder whether if you sat down, why don't you stand up right now? Why don't you shake them legs off and let's sing this song together. The worship team have put it together for us and it's an amazing song. And while we're doing that, we're going to give of our offering. And this is simply an act of worship because God has given us everything. He's given his one and only son. Everything that he has, he's given to us. And out of that, we give back what is rightfully his anyway. The Bible says about us giving cheerfully, and that's not necessarily talking about as we give with a sickly smile on our face with our teeth gritted. No, it's talking about giving cheerfully. Thank you, Lord, that we get to give this. Thank you that we can worship you with our finances. So let's do that as we sing our last song. And hopefully as I'm speaking right now, there's a link that will be popping up on the chat where there'll be many ways that you can give today. So let's sing, guys.
Your son for redemption.
What a great day it's been on Church Online today. We're so glad that you've been able to join us. On Tuesday nights, we're continuing to run prayer over Zoom at 7 p.m. We'd love to see you on there. During August, we will not be running the leadership track or Bible school, but they will be back in September. On the Church Online page, there is a Connect card. If you're new and you've recently found us, we'd love you to fill one of those out to find out more about Arena. If you've got a prayer need or a prayer request, one of our team would love to be praying for you, so please fill that out again on the Church Online page. There's lots of ways that you can give, and they are all found on the Church Online page again, or there'll be a give button coming up now to make it a little bit easier. We've loved having you today, and we can't wait to see you again next week.